Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. Welcome to our online Sabbath worship. We're so glad that you're here with us today, and we're glad that you're ready to worship God, because I know you are ready to worship God. You see, there's something that I like to do, which is keep track of things, keep track of time. And I realize that today is our ninth Sabbath since we last gathered together. I know, it's sad, right? Believe me, this church is not the same without you and without your family. I'm definitely looking forward to seeing all of you again here at church. And now, with this, I actually have some great news for you all. You see, the reopening church committee, I don't know if that's the name, but we're going to name it that. The reopening church committee met this week, and we're working on a plan to start gathering at church once again. Isn't that great news? Isn't that amazing? That's awesome. Well, we're trying to have everything in place before we meet. Of course, everything's sanitized. And the tentative date to meet is going to be June 6th. June 6th. So keep that in mind. June 6th, we're going to have church again, hopefully. We're hoping that we can have this building ready for you that day. So now with this, this leads to my second announcement, which is our website. I want to remind you to visit our website every week. That's how we keep in touch with you. That's how we update you of the things that are happening, like reopening the church. And that's how we keep in touch with you and also with the community. Because to be a church, we have to do something for the community. Even though we're socially distanced right now, we need to work for our community. So keep looking at our website, keep checking our website, and also check our social media, because we're going to post everything there as well. I want to recognize the faithfulness of our church family, because despite not being able to meet here at church, you have all been so faithful in supporting God's mission and His church with your tithes and offerings. We have received, let me just tell you, we have received 93% of our tithes and offerings through Adventist giving. Before we had 60%, you know, around 60%, but now it's 93%. So we appreciate all of you that are adapting to this new way of giving, to this online way of giving. You are being a blessing to our church. I just want to read Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 17, which says, "All must give as they are able, according to the blessings given to them by the Lord your God." Now let me ask you something. Hasn't God blessed you throughout this quarantine? Hasn't God shown you that He's taking care of you and your family? Haven't you seen that during this time? I have. He has taken care of me. So I think we all have been blessed by God because He has protected us and He has provided for each of us and for our families. So let's all bless others as God has blessed us. So bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we are so grateful because even, you know, despite everything that's happening right now, despite the situation, the crisis, you, God, you have blessed us so much. You have provided for each of us. So as we are blessed by you, we also want to bless other people in your church and your mission. So please, God, put in our hearts that desire of blessing you and blessing others. So please be with us, and may the tithes and offerings that we give, everything that we give you, may those honor you and be used for your glory and your mission here on earth. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Let the children come to me. Let the children come to me.
Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. I hope you're having a wonderful day. Today I want to talk to you about a pearl. You know, in the Bible it talks about a merchant that went all over looking for that priceless pearl. And once he found that priceless pearl, he went and sold everything he had so that he could obtain that priceless pearl. You know, boys and girls, pearls start off as grains of sand. and the grain of sand gets into this oyster. And when it's inside the oyster, it makes the oyster uncomfortable. I think it's like when you and I get a little stone inside our shoe. You know how uncomfortable that is? We take off our shoe and we shake it off so that we can take out that stone and we can continue doing what we want without being uncomfortable. Well, the oyster doesn't do that. What it does with the grain of sand, it hugs it and it starts smoothing it out slowly but surely. And in that process, while it's smoothing it out, it turns it into this beautiful pearl. You see how beautiful that is? It's shiny and it's white and it's gorgeous. You know, boys and girls, that is what Jesus has done for us. He came from heaven looking for that priceless pearl. And once he found it, he gave everything he had, including his life, so that he could obtain that priceless pearl. And you know what? You know who that priceless pearl is? Yes, you're right. It's you. It's me. Jesus died so that you and I could become those precious pearls to him. And you know why it's so important for him to have precious pearls? Because when he takes us up to heaven, he wants to present us to the Father as beautiful pearls. So boys and girls, next time you see a pearl, remember this. You are a precious pearl to our Savior, Jesus Christ.
So this is a time to praise our God. And I want you to sing with us. We're going to sing, Lord, I Need You.
Without you, I find. Let us seek God in prayer. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before you today because you are our God. You are powerful, mighty, long-suffering, merciful, kind. We are just amazed at who you are. And because of who you are, and because you have invited us to come to you and to seek you, we want to invite you into our presence, into our lives today, into our hearts. We want to praise you for what you have done for us, how you have worked so many miracles on our behalf, how you have intervened in our lives, how you have provided for us, how you've taken care of us. We have so many reasons to praise you and to lift you up. We have seen you working, and we thank you for what you have done. And because of what you have done, we know that we can trust you, and we can come to you in faith and ask for you to continue to be in our lives and to provide for us. Father, we need you so much. We need you in our hearts. We need you for salvation. We need you to change us. We need you to work in our lives. We need you to give us wisdom and understanding to know how to go about our everyday lives. We need you to cleanse us. We need you to cleanse our country, to heal our land. We need you in our world. We need you to take care of what is going on around us. We need you to solve this great problem, this scourge that is contaminating our world. Father, we need you now more than ever before. We need you to be here. And so we ask that you come. We ask that your Holy Spirit will dwell in our hearts, in our lives. We need an extra outpouring, a double measure of your Holy Spirit, Father. All these things we need, yet we know that you know what we need. You know what is best for us. Father, there are those of us in this family that are dealing with so many difficulties. There are some that may be having difficulties paying their rent, paying their mortgage, paying their bills. There may be those who are dealing with strained relationships. There are those who have health issues that we know about, and that they need your healing, your loving hand to be on them and to heal them. And so I ask on the behalf of our church family that you will attend to our needs and that you will work miracles. Father, please be with us. Please take care of us. As the great shepherd, we know that you care for your flock. And so we ask, Father, that you will care for each and every one in our church family. I ask for a blessing on each, and I ask that you will provide for the needs that you know there are. Father, I ask that you will be with our pastors, that your hand will be on them, that you'll give them wisdom and understanding to know how to take care of the matters of your church body each and every day. Give them wisdom and understanding to know what to do. And Father, may your Holy Spirit be on them. Touch Pastor Kevin's lips, and may he bring a message that is prepared for us. And may our hearts and minds and our ears be ready to receive it. We thank you for these things. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Our scripture reading today is found in Philippians 4, verses 4 through 7, which say, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Hi, good morning, Burleson Adventist Church, and happy Sabbath. Welcome once again to our worship online. We're so glad that you're here with us. And this is the place where we are finishing the ministry of Christ through love and action. And I'm not sure what creative ways you come up with to do that. If you have some, feel free to email us, send us a note, and tell us what you're doing. We'd love to hear, because these are unprecedented times. It's difficult, isn't it, when we're quarantined, to continue to show the love of Christ and to be his hands and feet. And we're always open to ideas. So share with us if you have something. I'm excited about this morning, and I'm excited as we continue with the sermon series that we started 2 weeks ago, if you recall, The Antidote for Anxiety, right? What a important message for times like right now, right? With the worries and the concerns and the stresses of life that we have all around us. And if you recall, 2 weeks ago, we were studying Philippians chapter 4. And if you'll remember, we realized there how the world was searching all over the place, desperate to find a cure for this $2.1 billion sickness called anxiety. And we recognized that while the world is searching for that antidote, we have it right here in Philippians chapter 4. And at the beginning of The Antidote for Anxiety, we saw what Paul reminded us of, which is to rejoice in the Lord always. You remember talking about that. And why were we rejoicing in the Lord always? Well, if you recall, because one, the Lord is God. We recognized 2 weeks ago how God is in control, how our God is a sovereign God sitting on his throne. And we also recognize that we need to rejoice in the Lord always because of God's grace and his mercy that he shows toward us. We also recognized we need to rejoice in the Lord always because it is God who has a really good plan for your life. And so today I'm excited as we continue on our journey in Philippians chapter 4 that we see more clearly the antidote for anxiety. Let's pray. Father, we need to hear from you this morning. And we pray the Holy Spirit now be poured out on your church, wherever we're located, that our hearts and our minds would be open to receiving your word, that we would understand with discernment from on high, that we would be convicted, that we would be finding hope and peace and joy in you. And so, Lord, have your way with us right now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, this topic of anxiety is such a serious one, and yet at the same time, as I was doing research, I came across a few memes that I thought might be appropriate to share with you, and so I thought I'd just share with you a few this morning. Here's one I liked. When someone asks me if I'm okay during an anxiety attack, this is my response, right? I'm fine. Why you ask? That's funny, isn't it? Or how about this, right? What can possibly go wrong, though? Anxiety. I'm glad you asked. And the millions of reasons anxiety will tell us go wrong will start to ensue, right? And then this one, this dog is so cute. When your anxiety goes away and you have no when your anxiety goes away and having no anxiety gives you anxiety. There's your facial expression, right? Oh man, it's good to laugh at something so serious. In fact, maybe you've heard the term, laughter is the best medicine. Well, it's good to laugh, but laughter is not the best medicine. You know what the best medicine is? It's found right here in God's word. Look at Philippians 4:4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. So remember 2 weeks ago when we learned what Paul was talking about when he said these words, we realized that Paul wasn't saying that we need to have this constant state of gladness. Do you remember that? But rather what Paul is talking about here is how we need to have this continual decision, this constant decision that we're going to rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. It means despite our circumstances, despite what we're going through, despite what is happening all around us, we say we're going to choose to rejoice in the Lord. And then Paul adds something peculiar to that, as if that wasn't peculiar enough. He says in verses 5 and in the beginning part of verse 6, he says, "Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything." Do not be anxious about anything. So first Paul says to rejoice in the Lord always, and now he's saying, do not be anxious about anything. Is Paul even human? I mean, has he lost complete and total touch with the human experience? I mean, what is he talking about here, right? In fact, if this is all we knew about the Apostle Paul, I think it's fair to say we might just dismiss him as being completely delusional. But we do know something about Paul. In fact, we know all the many things that Paul had to endure in his life. And by Paul's own admission, look at what 2 Corinthians reminds us of. He says, "I have worked much harder. I've been in prison more frequently. I've been flogged more severely and been exposed to death again and again." And in verse 24, he says, "Five times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea." He said, "I've been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, in danger from false believers." Is there a pattern here? "I've labored and toiled and have gone without sleep. I've known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked." And in verse 28, Paul says, "And besides everything else," he says, "I face daily the pressure of my concern for all the churches." And even now, as Paul is writing this passage to the Philippians, he's doing so in a Roman prison, waiting to meet with Nero, who just so happens to love killing Christians. So if anybody can speak to anxiety, it has to be Paul. And he's telling us this morning, church, he's telling us as clearly as possible, he says, do not be anxious about anything. How does that grab you? How does that settle? Right? When you hear Paul say that, how does that make you feel? Especially for those of you who actually struggle with feelings of anxiousness, what do you think? Oh, just get over it, right? Just turn it off. Don't be anxious about anything. Just make the decision to no longer feel anxious. It almost sounds dismissive, right? You know, it would be challenging enough if Paul just simply said, don't be anxious as much. Or if Paul had said, I tell you what, don't be anxious on the Sabbath, right? But Paul says, don't be anxious about anything. Got me thinking, is Paul really telling us, regardless of our experiences, of what we're going through in our lives, what scenarios we're facing, does he really tell us to not let anything bring us anxiety? I mean, is that what he's saying, that regardless of what we're going through, that we should have zero anxiety? I mean, on the surface, when you read it, that's kind of how it seems, right? But I don't think that's actually what he meant. For starters, some anxiety at the right time can be a good thing. Did you know that? Ever been in a dangerous situation? It's often our anxiety that is screaming to us to get out of there and to get out of there as fast as possible. And that is a good thing. Or how about being prepared for something, right? Just the right amount of anxiety at the right time can be the difference between everything going perfectly and the whole thing being a total and complete disaster, right? A little anxiety at the right time is, I believe, a good thing. But there's another reason why I don't think that Paul is telling us to never feel anxiety, and it's found in the Greek. When Paul pens this phrase, do not be anxious about anything, he writes this phrase in the present active tense, which implies an ongoing state. So what Paul is talking about here isn't a moment of anxiety. He's speaking to a perpetual anxiety. He's talking about the times when we overanalyze every word spoken in a conversation we recently had, right? Maybe you've experienced that. He's talking about those up all night times when we're thinking about what transpired over the course of the day, or maybe the last year, or maybe something that happened 30 years ago. He's talking about that constant angst. He's talking about that worry, that breathless dread. He's talking about all those horrible things that nagging anxiety brings. Paul is speaking to that. You know, I recently read, the presence of anxiety is unavoidable. But look at this. The prison of anxiety is optional. The presence of anxiety is unavoidable, but the prison of anxiety is optional. And I love that, don't you? I love it. And yet it doesn't feel like it's optional most of the time, does it? But see, that's the antidote for anxiety. That's what it is. It's the freedom from that prison. It's the freedom from that captivity. It's the liberation from that hold that anxiety has on us. And it is good news today, but it begs a question. If the prison of anxiety is optional, how do we remove ourselves from it? Right? How do we get free? How do we live a life that is free from that perpetual anxiety? And here's the answer. By understanding and clinging to this truth, this is the key that we're after today. Are you ready? Here it is. The Lord is near. Church, there it is. Right there in the heart of our passage in Philippians. Right? Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything. Right in the heart of our passage, we find the very heart of the antidote for anxiety. Knowing, believing, clinging to the fact that, ready? The Lord is near. Amen. In other words, you're not alone. You're not an afterthought. You haven't been forgotten. I mean, you may think you're alone. You may feel like from time to time that you're alone, but you are never alone, church. This is great news today. The Lord is near. In the middle of whatever it is that you're going through, God is there. He's with you in COVID-19. He's with you in the many of the other health challenges that you might be experiencing. He's with you in your relationship struggles. He's with you in the hurt that you have for others. He is with you. The Lord is near. You know, Scripture reminds us of God's promise to be with his people. Maybe you'll recall some of these. To Abram, God said, "Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your what? Your shield, your very great reward." And to Hagar, the angel announced, "Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there." See, God is present in these moments. To Isaac, when Isaac was forced from the land by the Philistines, God reminded him of this great prayer. He says, "I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not be afraid, for what? I am with you." And what did God tell Joshua after Moses died? Do you remember? He says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." I love that. In fact, we see it person after person in Scripture. We see God's presence with them. If you just take some time and read some of the stories that we find there, God was with David. Even after David committed adultery, he was with Jacob. Even after Jacob was dishonest and stole from his brother, God was with Elijah when Elijah was running afraid from Jezebel. God was there. God was with Ruth when she entered that foreign land. You remember Esther? God was with Esther when Esther bravely worked to rescue God's people. Story after story, God's presence is clearly seen. And still, if that weren't enough, look at what God does in Matthew 1:23. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him what? Emmanuel, which means God with us. Throughout his word, God says that he will be with his people. And then in the ultimate act of communion, God is with us in human flesh. I mean, that is unbelievable. Think about that for a moment. God becomes man. God, the creator of the universe, of all that is holy and perfect, A God whom nothing is impossible. He shrouds his divinity in humanity, and he actually shares in our experiences. This is God. He places himself on the receiving side of being in a world of sin, and in so doing, he feels the weight, the full weight of sin. He experiences the burden of this life. He, like us, endures the hardships of this world. God chose to do that, to be with us. I love what Ellen White writes in The Desire of Ages about Jesus being Emmanuel, God with us. Look at what she says. She says, since Jesus came to dwell with us, we know that God is acquainted with our trials and sympathizes with our griefs. Don't you love that? Every son and daughter of Adam may understand that our Creator is the friend of sinners. For in every doctrine, listen to these words, for in every doctrine of grace, every promise of joy, every deed of love, every divine attraction presented in the Savior's life on earth, we see God with us. Don't you love that, Burleson Church? I love that. And look at how Paul expresses something very similar in the book of Hebrews. Paul writes, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. In other words, our God, who not only loved us so much that he rescued us through his Son, Jesus Christ, but through his Son, Jesus, can empathize with us. He can empathize with you. He understands what it's like to be hurting. He understands what it's like to be hungry, to feel alone, to be mistreated. Jesus understands what it's like to not know for certain the future, but having to hold on by faith. You remember Gethsemane? Right? Jesus understands what it's like to be rejected and betrayed and to be cheated and double-crossed and even to be sold for a price. Our God understands temptation and human desire. Friends, our God gets it. He gets you. He understands you. Which is what makes the next passage in Hebrews and in Philippians so exciting. Hebrews 4:16, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Or as Paul puts it in Philippians 4:5-7, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You know, because God can do all things, because God is near, because he knows everything that we go through, we don't have to live in perpetual anxiety, because we can take all that stuff to him. And not only can we take it to him, church, but God actually wants us to. What an awesome invitation. You see, God doesn't want us to have fear. He doesn't want us to live this life worrying and carrying the burden of anxiety. You know what God wants? He wants you to cast your cares on the Lord. And he'll sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken. He wants you to, in Matthew 11:28, he wants you to come to me, he says, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. And church, God wants you to have peace. Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give it to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. So what is the antidote for anxiety? So far, there's more to come. But what is it so far? One, it's rejoicing that God is in control. It's rejoicing that God is merciful. It's rejoicing that God has a plan for your life. It's rejoicing that God is near. And finally, it's rejoicing in and accepting of his invitation to come. So church, I'd like to invite you. What is going on in your life right now? What are your fears? What are your anxieties? What are your concerns? What is happening right now that you at this very moment can just take and lay at the foot of the throne of our God in heaven? What is the thing that is burdening you that you can just drop off there with Jesus? I want to invite you to do it. Take this moment to just say a prayer, or maybe jot it down and say it when worship service is concluded. Whatever works best for you, but whatever it is, God is inviting you to take that thing to him and lay it at his feet. And I want to invite you to do that. Church, may you cast your cares on Jesus. May he give you peace as he lightens the burdens of your life. And may you rejoice in knowing that your God, the Lord, is near. This is my prayer for you today, church. Let's celebrate as we meditate on the words of our closing song, Ask.
If we just ask, ask.
Amen. And what an awesome reminder that song is of a God who is just inviting us into his presence. In fact, I want to invite you again. We have a website. We have prayer requests there. You can take time to read through those and lift up your brothers and sisters. You can share those with us as a church. But whatever you do, continue to take the burdens that are on your heart to God. Rejoice in him. Unburden to him. Take him up on his invitation because he has invited you to do so. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We go through so much in this world that is so much bigger and greater and more difficult than we can possibly fathom, and yet you can do all things. You can carry us through the storm. You can turn the storm away from us. Whatever it might be, Lord, you are greater than all of it. And so we bring to you, Father, the petitions of our hearts, the anxieties of the burdens we carry. And we thank you for being a God who desires to set us free of that. And so, Lord, as we celebrate the joy that we have in you and the freedom that we have in you, we ask now that you would bless us as we go through this week, blessing those around us. May we share the message of hope that we have in you with all those we come in contact with. We pray in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Church, God bless you. Have a wonderful rest of your Sabbath. We'll see you soon.